when I was younger was great, you know, to the people see that I had the great potential, but arrived to one moment where they compared me to Mark. And at this stage for me was motivation, but I didn't realize that was more pressure than motivation. So I finished the year in 2015 in a really bad way. I break my foot, and then, you know, not really bad decision, but circumstances that make that 2016-17 was really bad. And 18, I start to find my way to be better. So, yeah, I think the experience I have when I was younger helped me a lot to be good right now.
Hello and welcome to Last on the Brakes, the MotoGP podcast with myself, Matt Dunn, and alongside me as ever, Fran Wild.
Hello. That was quite a lot of pressure there. I didn't know what I meant to interject.
My bad. Yeah, we don't normally do it that way. Hey, this week, it's another French theme. We got Fabio Quartararo joining
Allez
us.
Bleu.
Yeah, it's absolutely, who are we going to get next? Louis Rossi, Jules Danilo, our French colleagues, maybe. Fabio Quartararo, we've been wanting to get this guy on for so long because it's in the short space of time that he's been up towards the top of the MotoGP Championship. It's not been so long since we first really met him in 2018, the year which changed his life forever. And he's got possibly one of, if not the most fascinating stories to tell in the entire MotoGP World Championships. So what are we talking about today, Fran?
It is a good one. I would say the key word for this one is stratospheric, isn't it? That rise, it really is. Yeah. And that's not really hyperbolic. So with Fabio, we're not really talking about this year too much, although obviously that comes into it. We're more talking about how he made it here, because if you don't know the story, he was two-time Spanish national champion, as it was at the time. It's now the FIM Moto3 Junior World Championship. Had so much hype coming into the Moto3 World Championship. You know, he was going to be quote-unquote the next Marquez, or the guy who was going to beat him. And then just a really difficult time over the first few seasons that he was in the World Championship. Started off okay, podium, and then just really tough time. And now, as you can see, it's rebuilt into quite an impressive career.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's an amazing journey, some incredible hard work to get there as well. So I think it's definitely a very good story.
Yeah, and this is, as you hear us talk a lot about, this is just a guy absolutely living the dream, apart from when he's forced to come and spend half an hour to chat about it with us.
Downside.
Yeah, that is the downside of being now, you know, one of the most sought-after characters in MotoGP now. So we really got to thank Fabio for his time. Question of the week. Well, to be honest, I think it's got to be, how do you deal with pressure in whatever situations you got going on in your own lives at home? Let us know in the comments below this YouTube video, or tweet us using hashtag MotoGP podcast. What is your go-to to dealing with pressure? You'll hear about Fabio's mechanisms and how what sort of general thought processes he goes through to deal with it. Fran, how do you deal with pressure? I'm putting you on the spot here. You weren't expecting this at all, were you?
No, but I was from the start of when you said that, because then I realised, we usually chip in. Well, as you will know, being my flatmate for a little while, usually I go really quiet and terse and just need to absolutely focus on what I'm doing and get left alone.
Yeah, and Ironica is kind of the same with me. We're both the same, eh? We just don't talk for a whole day.
This year as well, in lockdown, brought in a little bit of starting to get interested in yoga, which is quite a foreign concept, because you can tell I am Northern. It's not really the cultural background. I feel like it's more a Hampshire form of exercise. I'm trying my best, but yeah, I think it's a really interesting question though, isn't it? And of course, a big subject of the podcast with Fabio, not only now but also the journey he's been through with, he says, spoiler, even more pressure back when he was in the junior classes than he feels now.
Yeah, it sounds like that is actually almost the key to Fabio's success, which you're seeing at the very highest level now. So I think without further ado, we should probably stop doing an intro and throw to actually us chatting with Fabio, because it's a really awesome one once again.
Allez, allez! As you may be able to see already, today's podcast is with the inimitable Fabio Quartararo. Are we allowed to say it in the English way?
Yeah, it's Quartararo. Okay. The English way is okay.
Is less of a nightmare than some of the attempts.
Exactly.
So, if you're looking for scoops about this weekend or this championship, we're going to more talk to you this week, hopefully, about your journey here, which is kind of a crazy one. For a lot of different riders on the grid, we see a lot of different paths to MotoGP. Yours, though, we'll start off first. How do you feel now? You're fighting for the MotoGP World Championship. You've won 3 races already this year, more than anyone else. You had an amazing rookie season, and all from that kind of Moto2 win and that contract, and suddenly, whew, how do you feel now you're here and on top of the world?
Yeah, for me it's positive because, you know, from middle of 2018 till now, let's say my career changed quite a lot.
just a bit.
I got a bit.
Oh, no, I was saying just a bit. It's only changed a little bit.
No,
don't worry.
A lot. Because honestly, you know, when everything is going not so great, normally you always seeing negatives. But at this moment, I only feel the positive that I was working hard. And as soon as I get the first victory, podium in Assen, we already have talk with Johan, that is the team principal of the team this year. We had the MotoGP contract, and until there, everything is going so fast. Let's say we expect a good rookie season because we knew that the Yamaha is a familiar bike. But we make 7 podiums, 6 pole position. This year already 3 wins. So yeah, for me changed quite a lot, but in a really good way. So I want to keep going in the same direction.
I look at you, and especially your Instagram page. I saw, by the way, you've just got 1 million followers now on Instagram. You've seen that, like, wait. Yeah. No post, though. Were you not doing a post about it?
Yeah, I did it.
Oh, yeah? Thanks for 1 million followers?
Was in Barcelona.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And, yeah, I started last year's season 120.
Yeah, right.
And now I'm... It's pretty big, almost take 1 million in 1.5 years.
This is not bad. I hope you've kind of redone any deals there to make sure it reflects the new million.
Yeah. Now we're looking for the 2 million.
No, exactly. But I look at you, and especially your Instagram posts, and what I see these days is someone who's basically got almost everything they've ever dreamed of now. Like the clothes you wear, the things you're able to get, the places you're able to go, what F1 Abu Dhabi. You've got you must have like access all areas at Juventus, FC Barcelona, hanging out with Neymar and things like that. Have you been able to take a moment to step back and be like, what? Wow, this is everything I could have ever wanted.
Yeah, at the end, I can say that I'm living the dream, you know? I'm in a really good position right now. I'm enjoying it at my best. Of course, this year is tough for the COVID, but honestly, when I realize what I have done and what I'm doing with, let's say, people that actually are my idol from, let's say, Lewis in Formula One, Neymar in football, but let's say is many people that I dream to meet like 3 years ago, 4 years ago, even long time ago, and I can say that I'm talking to them, and I think it's great example, you know, to follow, to be inspired by this athlete, and at the end, yeah, it's so nice all the things that we do more last year for the condition, but yeah, to go to see some games and met some really interesting athletes to also take inspiration for me.
I guess as well, you, like we said, you've gone from, what was it, 120 to 1 million followers. You've gone from a Moto2 win to leading a lot of the championship this year and having all those wins. You must know as well that to someone on the outside, it's like, oh my God, Lewis Hamilton. But it's also just a person called Lewis, because you must get this a lot, right? When people are like, oh my God, Fabio Quartararo, and you're just like, well, it's just me.
Yeah.
I guess you got to know the people behind those names as well now and kind of see what puts them where they are.
Yeah, it's strange because, you know, when, let's say, my family or friends call me, it's by Fabio, is my name. But, you know, when you met some new people, example, yesterday I stopped at the petrol station and the guy recognized me and was special because at the end, 3 years ago, I just put the fuel and thank you, I pay and I go. And, you know, this year he's like, oh, you're doing well, how are you? And the guy was following a lot the MotoGP. So it's quite weird because at the end I say, I just do what I love, racing. And at the end, of course, you get, let's say, more people following you. But I still don't really realize all these things that now every time more people recognize me, and it's still a bit strange.
I think I always like to come back to this. There was this one story of when 2018, the French Grand Prix, you were part of the pre-event there, where it was like the MotoGP riders, the French MotoGP, MotoGP riders, with the scanning the tickets in.
Oh, okay, do you see that one? No, I was thinking of the one with the wig.
Oh, no, not that one.
The greatest sticker of all time.
We can't mention
it. 2015 was.
We'll have to find a photo and put it in the edit. But this one was funny because, like, you, Zarco, and Jules Danilo were scanning fans' tickets in. And to think that was literally the race before your win in Barcelona, before all of this happened. And at that time, you were scanning people's passing. Everyone was like, oh my God, Johan. And then a few less people were like, oh, hi, Fabio. And then poor Jules Danilo as well. There were a few less people like, hey, Jules. But then so you and Jules were kind of like quiet, less people saying hello to you. Everyone saying hello to you. But then the next year you get there, you're in MotoGP.
And
everyone's
like, there would be a full riot if you tried to do that again.
That's crazy. That must just be kind of difficult to cope with.
Yeah, because every year in Le Mans is always a lot of fans. But I can remember that last year was totally out of control, let's say. We just go down of the press conference was hundreds of people down the stairs and waiting. I say, wow, this is for me. What I do that good to be the people here? So, I couldn't imagine this year leading the championship after 9 races there. For me, like I said before, from 2018 to now is the biggest change I ever had.
I can imagine. And you obviously, as well, with our last podcast was with Johan, or Joan, should we say, more French, sorry.
Yes.
And you and him have such completely different journeys. So he was like a bit older. He started riding when he was a bit older, and then he took the two Moto2 championships. You were like the superstar of the future already when you were like 13, 14 years old and winning in the CV. Like, what do you think about this now? Because we see some of the older guys like Dovi, and Joan was a good example, where the experience pays. And now you've made it again, like everyone wants to find the new Fabio, the new Marquez kind of thing so early. What do you think about that and the kind of environment?
Well, I can say that when I was younger, was great, to the people see that I had a great potential, but arrived to one moment where they compared me to Mark. And at this stage for me was motivation, but I didn't realize that was more pressure than motivation. So I finished the year in 2015 in a really bad way. I break my foot, and then, not really bad decision, but circumstances that make that 2016-17 was really bad. And 18, I start to find my way to be better. So, yeah, I think the experience I have when I was younger helped me a lot to be good right now. Because for me, I spent 16 and 17, the worst years of my career. Because, never great result, always tough moments. But, when I'm looking at these years right now, I'm like, okay, the result was so bad. But I take a lot of experience, and I leave all the bad things that I leave when I was in these years helped me a lot to stay strong for these years. So at the end, was negative for the result, but really positive for the experience.
Your story is one of our favorites because it's such a high coming in, because everyone's like, what, look at this guy, the new Marquez, he's going to be the one to take it to Marquez. And then the years don't go as you think, and then all of a sudden it picks up and goes like that again.
Now last year it is the guy taking it to Marquez.
Yeah. So it came true. But I want to ask you a bit more about that hype and that pressure, especially in 2017, because as you said, you felt it was more pressure when people were saying that to you. How did you keep your head level enough and keep believing that you are going to get there, even when everyone had been saying you're the next big thing and then the results weren't there?
I knew the potential that I had, that I have and I had in this moment, because, I'm not a guy that like to complain a lot about the bike, but these years I was complaining and there was one race where, you feel good on the bike, and you make good result. And at the end, this is what make me feel that I was good, you know. And this is why I never give up and always train hard, because in 2018 I arrived to speed up and the boss just told me, keep like this, keep working in this way and you will arrive. And actually when he told me that, I was P28 in Argentina in the qualifying. And he put me in a really good mood that say, okay, I have no pressure from the boss. So I can work and keep going like that. And this is give me a lot of confidence. And from this moment, everything's go much better than what I expect.
Yeah, right.
I guess in some ways then, was it even more pressure before that year when you were meant to be kind of coming up and setting every category alight and winning it all? Do you think that was more pressure then when it was going badly than you even have now?
Yes. Yes, because, you know, for sure some riders, all the riders are different. But my main things that make me nervous or stressed is if I have a ride for the years later. And at this moment, in 2018, I signed 2 years with the Petronas. And I was much more calm, no stressed. My future is already clear right now. I will be in 2021 and 22 with Factory Yamaha. So this is the thing that can make me nervous. But, you know, then you learn during all the years that for sure, if I'm in the situation that I have no ride, for sure I will become, because I know the potential that I have right now. And I know that I can do some great results. And I had already tough time this year, but always working in the same direction to always feel good. But yes, in the past, the pressure was a bit more.
That's why I keep thinking whenever we've seen you have hard times this year, I think, well, at least whatever happens this year, no matter how bad it were to get, it's never going to be as much pressure and as difficult as maybe what you had before you came to MotoGP. Do you see it that way?
Yeah, I see it that way because, you know, the team was born last year. I arrived like a rookie that finished 10th in the world standing last year in Moto2. I'm second in the championship right now. The pressure is not on me. I mean, you know, there is the top four riders that are with me are all in the factory riders.
I've noticed this. Yeah. As in the press release every week for the preview, I put the standings. And at the start of the season, there are a lot more little asterisks for independent team. And now there's just you and Taka in the top five. The factory guys are really gaining now, no?
They're really there. And at the end, you can say like, okay, Juan is a rookie, but he's in a factory team that have a lot of experience in the past. They come back, they have a lot of evolution. Maverick is same, he's many years, he's MotoGP, Dovi the same. And I'm there in the middle of these guys that 2 years ago I was totally lost. And yeah, I'm just enjoying. I do my best. And if the championship, if not for this year, I will work a lot to be in the next years. But I have not really the pressure of the championship right now. The pressure is on them.
I think I remember back in Jerez last year when you had the pole position, then technical problem. And I think Tom was saying to you something like, Fabio, you're here for 10 years. You're here for 10 years. Calm down. Do you, in terms of 10 years to get your world championship? Is that what you keep coming back to?
Yeah.
Well, in that sense?
At the end, you know, you always, if I can win more than one championship, of course I won.
Yeah, 100%.
But is that moment where you say, okay, was my fourth race in MotoGP. I do pole position. I was there to fight for the podium. And this moment you say, okay, I have a lot of more races to come. And I can make more podiums than just one race in Jerez. So this moment was important for me because was up in emotion, but then really down because I had a technical problem. But this moment was important because make me feel that I had the speed to fight for podiums and wins.
I guess, yeah, you can take the positive there from knowing you were going to get that if not for that technical problem. I guess it's a little bit different to a crash, no? The frustration, yeah, if you have a technical problem because you know it's not you. So you're like, okay, well.
Yeah, the end technical problem is a shame because you do nothing wrong. But you can say in your head that, okay, it's not really my fault. I was second, technical problem. You feel okay. But of course, at this moment, even if I had a crash, I would say, okay, I was second. Yeah, I wanted to try for my first podium and I crashed. But yes, there is different mood in what is your problem, crash or technical problem, or even yourself sometimes. So it's never really easy.
No. Did you say anything to Jake after his crash in Le Mans?
Yeah.
In Le Mans, that was heartbreaking to watch him by the side of the track.
Yeah, was tough because it's from few races that we are always together. I think he's a really good guy and a really good friend. And for me, what he did in Le Mans was fantastic. Okay, he crashed, but I just told him, how many times do you lead a Moto2 race for almost all the race that you came from six and you overtake them all, just some go wide. But I think the experience he take there, he never take it in no races. So I say, for sure you will arrive to the next races and make a big step. And it finally, he make fourth here last week. I just step by step, you need to make mistakes, and he did the good one, let's say, crashing in first position. So
it's better than crashing from like 20th, right?
Yeah, exactly. So exactly what I say to him: better crashing first than when you are in the back of the group.
So before, because I know we're very conscious of time, because you are incredibly busy, obviously. So we got a couple more things to discuss you before we let you go. Last topic we wanted to ask you about was the people who support you around you. Some riders, you see them and they've got a massive entourage, loads of people around them to help lift them up. Your circle seems really small, like obviously with COVID and the restrictions of how many people we have, it's that guy behind the camera, Tom, and that's basically it, and your manager, Eric. How important is not just Tom to you, but also your family in helping you deal with that pressure?
You know, at the end, the people who are here are Tom and Eric, but you know, I'm always having my family by night. We make like kind of a video with my brother, my mother and dad.
Do you ever do the full like FaceTime and then eat food together or anything?
Yeah, but that's what I normally do.
Yeah,
but in these circumstances, I like to eat and then have a walk and call them. So this is normally what I used to do. But when I'm in Andorra, I'm doing exactly this. When I'm eating, just put the phone and call them. But for me, it's important to have my family. You know, they are proud of what I do. So my mom, of course, she's always saying it's good. Be careful. But, you know, they know that it's not in few races that you can fight for a championship. And what I do this year, they are quite impressed. So they just say, okay, do your best. And the best will be enough, because nobody expects in the second year what you are right now. So you can be more than happy.
No, for sure. And you, like we said, you are the independent team rider who's been winning those races, breaking those records. So everyone loves you too much. So they think you have to win it and that's it. And that's the only thing that we'll do. But it's just not quite the situation when you are you, is it? You're just like, well, I've only just arrived here. Now I'm winning.
Yeah, but at the end, when I look at the media, it's like, I am the one that needs to win this championship. I'm the one that needs to win, but keep calm, guys. It's my second year. I'm in a satellite team that was built 2 years ago. Look at all the riders that are here for many years that are in the factory team. Mm. But this is what I don't understand. And at the end, I say, okay, for me, it's not kind of a pressure, but if they're looking at me, is also really good, because
they see me. I was going to say, it obviously comes from a good place.
Exactly, come from a good place. But I think right now the pressure is not on me, and more in the top five riders, more top four, because Taka is coming. But let's say the top is Maverick, Joan and Andrea, that at the end, for me, the pressure is on them. I'm just enjoying my best this year, because 3 wins is already a big achievement for me. So everything goes that fast. So just want to take it slowly.
Yeah, yeah. And outside of the racing, as we said at the start, you're living it up. You've got all the clothes I imagine you could have ever wanted and stuff like that. It's awesome. Like, it's cool to see, because, you know, like, good for you, man, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And also, you know, many people talk about the clothing and everything, but I like to be different. And I think is also cool. It's your style.
It feels like in the media nowadays, everyone complains if you're the same, and everyone also complains if you're different. So whichever you do, someone's going to have a problem, right?
Yeah. At the end, you know, the most important is to always keep the feet on the ground. That many people told me that. And the first of all is my family. You know, my dad teach me a lot when I was from three, when I was starting racing. And from this moment, he said, keep the feet on the ground.
No, good.
And I think that was the most important advice that I had. Because it's important to always be in your place and not with the feet flying. So
yeah.
I think that's ruined important. A quick fire question.
Yeah, it has actually already. it's one of the questions on there. Damn it! No, that's the thing. Like, I mean, we'll say one more thing. Then we got to do the Ken with quick fire.
Okay.
Right? But I think back to like me and Fran first started traveling to races frequently. It was 2018, obviously your key season. And I remember when I did my first interview with you for the French side of MotoGP.com, and like you were confident, having a good time, happy to meet new people, but you were quite shy with your English and kind of shy in general and quite giggly, you and Danny Kent playing games. But and even though you are so much more confident now, I feel like I see you're walking around very sure of yourself, you still seem the same Fabio, which is really nice to see. And I guess that's down to your parents and the people around you, right?
Yeah, and I think this is so important, you know, that actually also the relation you build with your friends, your family, is not that because I moved to MotoGP and doing great results that I need to change. Mm. Everything is good, everything is working well, so I'm the same. Of course, I take a little bit more experience with my English and feel
it's great
more,
now.
More comfortable, yeah. Still needs to improve, but, you know, when I start the first years, I was shy because I didn't want to make mistake, and for sure I'm doing a lot right now, but I try to improve myself every time I'm doing interviews and media and try to express myself the best way as possible, but I'm the same, just in a different category that was from Moto2 to MotoGP, yeah. But I'm exactly the same as before.
Awesome.
That's cool. And for the record, you're saying like, oh, I'm working on my English, but you're like fluent in Spanish.
Yeah.
Obviously French as well. Yeah. Like you're the nightmare on the interview set because you could just talk to everyone in their language.
Yeah. It's like and the worst is that Spanish and Italian, there is a lot of word that is similar.
Oh, God.
And why I'm to Italian TV, I'm talking Italian with Spanish words and to the
really hard to separate.
Spanish for me was no problem, but as soon as I start Italian, sometimes I make like kind of a mix.
Yeah.
And sometimes
and then
it's
you
disaster,
end up with
yeah.
Catalan.
No, Catalan not yet.
Right, okay, so cool. Before we let you go then, Kenwood Quickfire. Kenwood, they do the radios
like
for MotoGP.
I have not that eyes yet.
So thank you, Kenwood, as ever, for sponsoring this final segment. It's a quickfire round, but you can elaborate on your answer if you like. So the first question, got to ask you, do you prefer coffee or tea?
I prefer tea.
Yes. You're like the second person to say that in 23
European
episodes.
Yes,
drama
but let
here.
Me finish. I prefer tea. But when I need to, sometimes I'm feeling asleep, I take a coffee. But I don't really like coffee.
So coffee is like for practical reasons.
Exactly, practical reason.
So what about running in the mountains or along the, is it called Promenade des Anglais?
Promenade des Anglais.
Or, you know, the seaside vibe, doesn't have to be in Nice.
For me, I always like to be at home. Unfortunately, I'm not there a lot of times. But when I go, I like to run in the Promenade des Anglais. Because it's always peaceful. I go with my friend or with my headphones that sometimes is really nice.
So you can't hear everyone yelling, Fabio. No.
Just, you know, to be in the best way as possible, you know.
Yeah. Okay, so what's your favorite video game?
You know, I play so much in the quarantine that actually I think is from July that I don't play on the games.
No way.
But I would say Fortnite because it's a game that I spend a lot of hours and days in the game, and I think it's quite funny. So I would say Fortnite.
Okay, cool. What about your dream car?
I don't really have a dream car. I'm already really happy of what I have. Because I would have not imagined already at my age have what I have. But let me think about it, and maybe I will come back to
okay,
you.
We'll come back to it. Okay. Why are you known as El Diablo?
Because when I was a child, I had an helmet, replica helmet from Roberto Locatelli. And the main rival I had when I was 6 years old called me El Diablo in Spanish. And then
reputation early.
Yeah, cool. El Diablo. And then, you know, when we finished the practice or the race, we always go to play football or bicycle or scooter. Nice. And then was 50 kids, so all the 50 kids called me El Diablo. And then I grew up with this nickname.
Sweet.
That's cool. I like that story. What's your favorite win celebration so far?
Well, this is easy because I don't win a lot. So I would say the one of my first victory in Barcelona, that was from Nusret. Because
you destroyed everything.
I just was there and crossed the line and I say, what can I do? And finally I do that.
Yeah.
So was so funny, and I think was great because I was the first one really to do that, you know, in a motorcycle.
And you know him now, right? You message him sometimes?
No.
You don't yet? No.
I just take a picture with him in Monaco in the Formula One. But it was quite strange because, you know, he's always special. You do a celebration with him, and even if he's a cooker, he's was cool to see him. Yeah.
Good meme. No, okay. Cool. What's your best race ever? Same answer, I guess, probably.
Best race ever, I would say Motegi in Moto 2. That actually for me is a win. Just
that's a controversial choice.
Yeah. No, but for me is my greatest race because it was Pecco behind me all the laps, all the race. It was 22 laps, I think, and I led almost all the laps and finished in front of him. That was the world champion of that year. And of course, Thailand with Mark, that was behind all the race, zero mistakes. I did some really good races, but I think Moto 2 Motegi, I'm really proud about this race.
Okay, that's cool. Which celebrity inspires you the most and why?
Right now, I would say Lewis Hamilton, because he is first in the world of racing, and he's a person that he beat the record of Michael Schumacher 2 weeks ago, last week. And he never stopped really dreaming of winning more and more and more. And I think this is the mentality you need to keep to always be to have success. Never stop working, always winning, always in, like he never won a race and he's always there to fight. And also out of the race, the image that he have is really powerful. And I think he's one of the best example right now to follow for an athlete.
Brilliant. That's really cool. Okay, two more then, even though one you kind of answered already. What's the worst advice you've ever been given?
I will not say an advice, but, you know, just a quote that normally a lot of boss tell you that I take you to win, not to finish in this position.
Ooh.
And I think this is like kind of a motivation that think is good, but is the worst that you can do to a rider. So I would not say it's an advice, but this is the worst things that a rider can have. Just not motivate him in this way. So this is the worst things that people told me.
Got you.
Okay. So then finally, what's the best advice that you could give to a young rider?
I had this question last week and in the press conference, but in general, the most important when you're young is to have fun. And this is the best advice I can give, because if you are not having fun and your parents are pushing so much to you for doing this sport, is not the correct way. If the kid love it and enjoy is the most important thing, and then he will have the time to train and to think what he wants to do. But if he enjoy, he will be happy, and is the best advice I can give.
brilliant. And that's you. That's you enjoying it, loving it.
Of course, still enjoying it.
Yeah. We did have a funny moment yesterday with Hiroshi Oyama doing something with him. And he said the first time that he got taken to ride a bike, he didn't want to do it and he was crying and he hated it and he didn't want to do it. And his dad was like, no, you have to try it.
Yeah, that's not good.
But as soon as he tried it, it was like, okay, I've made a huge mistake. This is amazing.
The first time is always special, for sure.
Hey, Fabio, right. Thank you so much for your time. No, you know you've got to go. Really appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
And your press officer. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.
So, welcome back. Hope you enjoyed that podcast with Fabio. As ever, we were going to give you a few things to look up this week after that conversation. We were just talking about it now, trying to choose a couple of things. I was going to go for that Motegi Moto 2 race, which, in case you don't know, I don't think we mentioned at the time, we just went, ooh, controversy. It was actually a race that he was then later disqualified from for a technical infringement. So that's why it's not on the results page, if you don't remember it and you're looking for it. But it was an impressive performance, like you said, and also that celebration in Catalunya. Classic.
Yeah, the old Salt Bay thing going on there. For me, I think a colleague of ours, I think Neil Morrison, might have sent it to me during the week. The press conference from when Fabio won pole position or something in 2015 when he was first in the world championship. Nick Harris in the press conference interviewing him, and he said, "Yes, Fabio, doing it in English." And Fabio went, "Whoa." and his answers were basically, "I'm really happy, let's go really fast tomorrow," and that's all he could say. And I think that's a really good thing to look up to, remind yourself of this guy. This is 2020, his first year in the world championship was 2016 was his first year in the world championship.
Yeah, because that one you referenced it slightly wrong there. I think it's from the CV.
CV, I'm pretty sure it was. If they went to the, it's 2015 and 2016. He was with the Australian.
We're confused because the CV traditionally joins the MotoGP paddock at Le Mans.
But when it first became the junior. We digress.
We digress.
The point is, it was amazing to see in such a short space of time the person that he's become and the racer that he's become. And that little, I think that's quite demonstrative. If you can go and look up an old press conference from his CV days or even his first year in the world championship and see how little English he spoke, how shy, but also how he still had that cheeky nature, it shows the difference between who he was then and who he is now. And I think it's absolutely awesome. Who have we got coming up? We haven't got anyone organized at the moment, do we? But
yeah, we actually don't. We know who we want to talk to, but
we're coming to the final few actual episodes of the 2020 Last on the Break season, but we're gonna be going out with some bangers, that's for sure. So I guess we'll see you in a few weeks.
Hopefully. Is that your sign off?
Yeah.
See you in a few weeks.
Bye.
I also said I was going to race you and I haven't yet had the opportunity. The reason that Matt is now wearing his jacket in a strange reverse reality is because he dropped water right down himself before we started to record the intro and outro.
Yeah, so
hope you enjoy that. Thanks for joining us as ever. Anything that you want to get in touch about, MotoGP podcast hashtag, wherever you want to put it. And in the comment sections, always let us know what you think. And we'll see you soon, hopefully, with someone equally exciting.
Bye.